or see in my screen now? Excellent. Okay. So I am really excited to be here to talk to you guys about this topic. This is a topic that's kind of near and dear to my heart. And I got interested in food systems, food security back in med school as I started to notice that we had a lot of dietary related diseases, and I got curious about that. And you don't have to look into the food system for long before you see how food systems and agriculture impacts climate change and vice versa. But I also get really excited because this is an area that we have a lot of health problems currently, and fixing those can also be a great opportunity to mitigate climate change as well. So it's kind of like a double win. Oops, sorry. So I just wanted to start learning a tiny bit about you guys. Where did you grow up? How far did you live from the closest farm? What's your specialty and what's your favorite food? And I just realized I can't see the chat. Okay, I'm gonna stop sharing for 1 second. So if you guys want to put that in the chat, I just want to get to know you a tiny bit. And sorry, I'll tell you the questions again. Where did you grow up? How far did you live from the closest farm? What specialty are you going into? And what's your favorite food? Phoenix. Anyone else? Awesome. So actually a fair number of you grew up near farms, which is a little bit more unusual. Okay. So here's just a little roadmap of where we're going to go today. I'm going to start out talking about some definitions and kind of describing the problem a bit, and then moving into how climate change impacts our food and water security. And then, because this can be kind of a depressing topic, we're going to end on, you know, what's the way forward. So it's important to understand a food system to understand how that can be disrupted. So in this is from Arizona Food Systems Network, and I think it's a really nice depiction of the food system. It starts with, you know, what we all think of: the growing, raising livestock, foraging, moving into how food is processed, transported, distributed, the retailing and how it's marketed, preparation, cooking, ultimately how we eat it, how we manage our waste, and then things like food safety and stewardship of our land and water and environment. And at the heart of this, I like that they put, you know, that this needs to be sustainable, equitable, have sharing of wisdom amongst groups, respectful, and respect human rights. This is a different look at it. And primarily, I just wanted to focus on the drivers of the food system, because this is, it's a pretty complicated topic, and it's a pretty complicated area with a lot of people involved. So you can't think of a food system without thinking of the political and leadership, the population changes, the sociocultural dynamics, income, land use, and that all drives, you know, the food supply chains, the environments, individual choices people make, and then ultimately affects our environment, nutrition and health, social equity, and our economy. So I'm going to give you a bunch of slides. Just sit back, take it in. I'll kind of give you the take-home point. I just want to give you an idea of what our food system looks like, because sometimes I think there's a little bit of a myth of what our food system looks like from what's actual reality. So this is looking at agricultural output globally from the 1960s, when our agricultural production really sped up. So you can see in that time frame, we've increased agricultural production significantly. And there's a lot of reasons for that. We've built in a lot of efficiencies. So machinery, fertilizer inputs, we've gotten really good at getting water. We tend to grow crops more in monocrops, enabling some, ability to scale. And then we've also increased our footprint on the land for how much land is being used for agriculture. So this scale, this goes back to 1600, so it's not the same scale, but you can see that over the last, 100, 150 years, a lot more land has gone for agriculture globally. This is US data. So this is looking at fertilizer use in the US since the 1960s. So yellow is nitrogen, pink is phosphate, blue is potash, that's potassium. So you can see that we're putting a lot of input into our crops, although it's not rising to the extent that it did initially. And then what are we growing globally? So globally, we're growing predominantly cereals and coarse grain. These are things like oats, barley, a lot of things that go towards livestock. Oil crops have been on the rise. And then down here is our fruits, vegetables, nuts, pulses, legumes, lentils, things like that, potatoes. So just a picture of what we're growing in the US. So crops on the left, animal products that we're raising on the right, similar amounts. Corn and soybeans dominate what we produce here in the US. And interestingly, corn, a little less than half of corn goes to feed livestock. A little less than half goes for ethanol production, and around 10% goes for human consumption, of which about a third goes to produce high fructose corn syrup. Also important to understand how subsidies fit into the agricultural system. So governments provide subsidies in the forms of crop insurance, conservation plans, lots of different things. But corn, soybeans, wheat, cotton, and rice are our most subsidized crops. To some extent, that's reflected in the crops that are grown. And then here's the breakdown of livestock and animal product production. So cattle, calves, dairy, and then poultry and eggs. So I think a lot of us, when we think of farms, we think of small family farms. So I just wanted to show kind of what the reality of our farm size is, and this is again US data. So we had an increase in the number of farms up until about the 40s. And then that has decreased, where average farm size has really increased. If you look on the right, this is looking at farms by source of income. So you can't see the line. There is a line here, but small family farms are not making a lot of money from farming. Most of them are making money from off-farm income, but the large-scale farms are predominantly making farm income. And this is just important because where there's money, there's power. And so lobbies, subsidies, things like that. Most of the subsidies actually are going to these farmers, with very few subsidies coming to smaller farmers. So that makes a difference in what crops are grown, how things are grown, things like that. So this is a fun look at global land use. So 29% of Earth is land, 76% of which we can inhabit. And we use 45% of that for agriculture. And when you break that down, 80% of it goes for livestock raising, meat, dairy, and textile production. And then 16% goes for crops for food. So if you look at this as global calorie supply, actually globally, 83% of our calories are coming from this 16% of crops. And 16%, 62% of our protein is coming from these crops. And then the orange is the percentage of calories and protein coming from animal products. So this is a different way of looking at that same thing. This is looking at per 100 grams of protein, how much land is used. So if you see at the top, lamb, beef, cheese, milk, beef, pig, all of these protein sources require a lot more land than, say, nuts, pulses, eggs, grains, things like that. Okay, and I know factory farms, I just have to talk about it for a second. It's important to understand when we talk about climate effects, how our animals are living, because our livestock have a lot of impact on us with disease. And so our chickens predominantly, almost exclusively, live in factory farms conditions. Farmed fish obviously live in farms. 98% of egg laying hens, almost all turkeys, 70% of cows, and most of pigs live in factory farm settings. And we'll talk about more about some of the risks that this poses to the food supply in a little bit. So agrodiversity, so this is kind of the genetic diversity within our food system. We've moved to a point that nine plants make up two-thirds of our global crop production. And 75% of the world's food currently comes from 12 plants and five different animal species. So over time, because of this, we've lost about 75% of our plant genetic diversity, and 30% of our livestock breeds are at risk of extinction. So why does this matter? So it matters because a lack of diversity increases risk for crop disruption by pests. It increases risk of disease. If a fungal disease moves into a crop and it's all the same crop, then you risk losing the entire crop. And low diversity limits our abilities to adapt. So going forward, we're going to need to have, more drought-resistant crops, more heat-resistant crops, animals that potentially can live in hotter, drier climates. So not having that diversity limits our ability to adapt. It's also important to realize that we typically only eat 150 to 200 of all edible plants, whereas, and this estimate varies, but there may be as many as 50,000 edible plants out there. So we have a really global food system, and I'm just using the US as an example of this. This is US exports. So we export a fair amount of the grains, oils, fruit and tree nuts, and meat products that we produce. And then here is our imports. We import a lot of sweeteners, a lot of fruit, vegetables, and some grains. And here's just a picture so you can visualize. Here's where we're sending food, and here's where we're buying food from. So all around the world. So it's important to look at the carbon footprint, the greenhouse gas emissions that come from agriculture, because this is actually a big part of climate change. Most current estimates say that up to 30% of all global emissions come from agriculture. And so these come from a lot of places, the supply chain, certainly livestock and fisheries. So this is where you hear about the methane emission from cows, how manures and pastures are managed. Then crop production. So we have it divided by human food and animal food, and then land use, which is kind of an opportunity cost for trading something that could be taking up carbon for something that may be emitting carbon. So livestock and human land use. And then food waste. A good portion, estimated about 30% of our food that's produced, is wasted. If this is kind of disturbing, if the greenhouse gas emissions of food waste was a country, it would be the third largest country. And there's different portions of the food supply chain that contribute to food waste. You're looking at the orange here. So here's what's wasted in production, in post-harvest handling and storage, processing, distribution, and then once it gets to the consumer. And that differs depending on the region. So on the left, these are the industrialized regions, and we tend to waste more food at the consumer end, whereas in less developed countries, there's more food waste that happens, on the production, transportation, storage end, which, if you think about infrastructure, that makes sense. So any questions, feel free to come off mute before I move on.
And one question, you said pulses. What is a pulse?
Pulses are lentils, and a lot of the different beans and peas and things like that fall into that category. Okay, so I just want to talk about when we talk about food security, what do we mean? And this is kind of the global definition. It exists when all people at all times have physical and economic access to sufficient, safe, and nutritious food that meets their dietary needs and food preferences for an active and healthy life. And you'll see that definition. And there's kind of four parts to food security. There's the availability of food. So, is it being produced and is it in an area that you can access it? And then food access is more like the economic and physical means. Like, do you have transportation to get the food? Do you have the money to buy the food? That kind of thing. Utilization is looking more at can you actually eat and use the food that you obtain? So family dynamics come into this. In a lot of part of the world, women will be the ones who eat last and who eat least. So food utilization is lower for females in a lot of places. This also water sanitation comes into play. Access to the ability, the means to cook food, access to healthcare, and having a body that's healthy enough to digest and process the food. And then finally, stability. So how is that access to food stable and ensured over time, or is it periodically disrupted? And then, sorry, this is a little bit blurry, but this is just looking at different types of food insecurity. So moderate food insecurity, a lot of times they're maybe not choosing food that's healthy. It's not the best food. There's uncertainty about where the next meals are coming from. And then moving into severe food insecurity is you're going days or more without having a meal sometimes. And food insecurity differs greatly across the world. So globally, we have about 900 million people who with severe food insecurity and 2.3 million people. That's wrong. 2.3. Sorry, I think that's two. Yeah, 2.3. 2,300 million people. There we go, 2.3 billion. So the proportion of people, depending on the region that you're looking at, particularly Africa, there's a high proportion of people who are moderately or severely food insecure. And then when you look at more industrial nations, it's lower. Then this is just a look at the US because food insecurity differs here by state. So the South, much more issues with food insecurity. And food insecurity also differs by household composition. So particularly when there's a single adult in the house, especially when that's a woman, those households are more food insecure. We have racial differences. Black and Hispanic households have higher levels of food insecurity, and then it correlates with poverty. So, does anyone want to venture a guess what drives food insecurity? Okay, I'll tell you. So it's actually interesting or disturbing. Globally, we currently produce enough calories to feed everyone a sufficient diet. But that's disrupted by these are the top three means. Conflict and insecurity is kind of the number one disruptor of food security. Economic shocks, this is things like COVID is included in this. The war in Ukraine is included in this. There's a lot of sanctions on Russia, which impacts prices of natural gas, which is used to make fertilizers, nitrogen-based fertilizers. So we've seen a huge rise in the cost of nitrogen-based fertilizers globally. And then we're going to focus a lot on this. So weather extremes, this has been very disruptive to food security. And what are the impacts of this? So I like this chart. They break it down in a really nice way. So there's distorted eating patterns, like not getting enough to eat, having sporadic access to food, leading to undernutrition, childhood stunting or wasting, and overweight and obesity. There's poor nutrition, just not getting enough calories, not enough micronutrients. So that leads to micronutrient deficiencies, premature mortality. Poor health and general disability, but also hunger of the body. So poor work capacity, poor ability to concentrate, poor academic achievement. And then they call this hunger of the mind. So violent behavior, risk-taking behaviors, suicides, things like that. All those can be a factor. So malnutrition is really just either not getting enough food or not getting the right kinds of food. And that can manifest as undernutrition, micronutrient-related nutrition, or overweight and obesity. And each of these kind of has a different pathway. Wasting, stunting. This used to be called kwashiorkor. I think that term is falling out of favor now. Micronutrient globally, iodine, vitamin A, and iron deficiencies are the most common. And then the consequences of overweight and obesity, which we all know well in the US. Just going to talk briefly about each of these. So, stunting is low height for age. This is typically associated with chronic or recurrent undernutrition and results in poor cognitive performance, lost productivity and wages as an adult, and increased risk of chronic diseases. And this is largely irreversible once set in place. Wasting, which used to be sometimes is called marasmus, this is low weight for height. This is more of an acute type illness, although this can certainly be superimposed on stunting. It's predominantly seen in young kids, less than two. There's a high risk of mortality for kids with wasting, and they go on to have neurodevelopmental delays and behavioral problems, poor academic performance, and low wage earnings. So these have not only health consequences, but they also have societal and economic consequences. And I just want to kind of talk a little bit about the pathway for obesity with food insecurity, and social determinants of health definitely play a role in this, but that can be kind of counterintuitive. How does obesity come from not having enough food? So it comes from things like cycles of food deprivation and then overeating when food is available, limited resources available to cook with, high levels of stress and anxiety and depression, and the hormonal milieu that accompany those, less opportunities for physical activity. There's actually a greater exposure to marketing for products that lead to obesity. There's limited access to healthcare, and in general, healthy foods tend to be more expensive. So there's a lack of access to that. So I am not talking specifically much about water security because I know you've already had an awesome lecture about that. So I'm going to focus mostly on how water impacts food systems, but this is just a reminder that water security encompasses, drinking water, water for sanitation and hygiene, water for all the economic activities that we need, including producing food and energy, protecting our water systems from hazards and from climate change, and then preserving ecosystems so they can continue to provide the ecosystem services that we rely on. And this all depends on cooperation between nations, good governance and laws, peace and political stability, protecting infrastructures, and then the financing to maintain all of these processes. Oops, sorry. Okay, so that was a lot. We're going to shift gears, but before I shift gears, are there any questions?
On the slide where you said we could produce kind of all of the caloric needs for everybody, is that just talking about the United States or like worldwide?
Globally,
Okay.
yeah, globally. Although I would imagine it's probably true for the United States specifically also. Okay. So I'm going to shift gears now into talking about how climate change specifically impacts food security. And there's a lot of ways, there's a lot of information in here. So you'll have it as a resource. I'll give these slides to Brian when I'm done. But it helps to think about this food system again and think about how climate change can impact kind of each of these bubbles, if you will. And I'll go through some of these specifically. So impacts on agricultural productivity. And this is kind of the most obvious one that we think of. This is an interesting look at corn over the years. And you can see all of the weather-related events associated with climate change. that have impacted production. And it's pretty significant impacts when those events hit. So crops are susceptible to heat stress and drought. We know that. Less obvious things, wildfires, other than just straight burning of crops. Oops, sorry. Smoke can damage crops. Fire damages the soil, making it harder to grow in the future. We have shifting growing seasons, so things like pollinator and plant mismatch, where the pollinators are coming at a different time than the plants are ready to be pollinated. Also, things like early warming, so plants start to bloom and flower, and then we have freezes that are kind of unexpected, and that can wipe out a crop. Pests, unfortunately, seem to do better in warmer temperatures, and so we're expecting to have, and we already do have, increased pest attacks on crops, and then increased CO2, which is a little bit paradoxical. So if you all remember photosynthesis, CO2 helps plants grow. It's, they make the sugar to grow with CO2. And so you actually increase plant growth with increased carbon dioxide. However, you do not increase nutrient uptake or micronutrient uptake. So you end up with bigger plants that have lower protein and lower nutrient content. So our soil, which is a really important part of agriculture and plant growing, is impacted by climate change. So things like decreased soil moisture obviously affect plant growth. The water storing capacity of our soils are changing. We have a lower organic content because the organic content is carbon, and carbon is increasingly metabolized by our soil microbes as they speed up their processes with warmer temperatures. We end up with extreme events like, heavy rains and flooding will make soils run off. And I talked about the fertilizer use, and I'll talk about this a little bit more later, but we can have runoff of fertilizer, pesticides, and things like that into our water supply. And then we can get increasing salinization of the soil, which impacts growth, both by having water evaporate out and salts remaining behind, but also by rising sea levels. So impacts on our water systems, extreme precipitation, so that agricultural fertilizer runoff gets into our water systems. And if you've heard of eutrophication, you get an explosion of plant growth in aquatic plant species when you get that particularly nitrogen and phosphorus rush into the water, and then that uses up all the oxygen and you end up with a die-off of fish and shellfish. You can also get profuse bloom of algae leading to the toxins associated with that. You can have runoff from those factory farms that I just talked about. So you can have runoff of waste from those farms, and that can move into crops. That gets disease can be present in the water. Ocean warming and acidification. So we're seeing declines in some fish populations, including some, those that love cool water. We're seeing migration of fish stocks to cooler waters with changes in accessibility for fishing. There's changes in coral, plankton, shellfish. These things form the foundation of the food web in the aquatic system. So impacts to those systems have impacts throughout the whole food web. Rising sea levels. So fish and wildlife habitats tend to be kind of right on the nexus of where they join. So changes in those habitats. Sea level impacting agricultural land, so decreasing areas to grow crops. As sea levels rise, there's intrusion of salt water into aquifers, causing, kind of ruining those as irrigation sources and drinking water sources. And then drought, that one's kind of obvious, just decrease water for all of our needs. So climate change also impacts food safety from a disease standpoint. So when it warms up, the pathogens tend to increase their growth, some of which increase their virulence and have prolonged survival in the environment. So when we have things like flooding and we get pathogens into our agricultural systems, we start to see rises in things like Salmonella, Campylobacter, E. coli, we can see some of the rises in like the non-cholera or non-cholera vibrio species, things like that. Food scarcity also can cause people to shift to foods that are not ideal, so more unsafe foods. And then water scarcity can decrease people's ability to practice good sanitation and hygiene. It's also important to look at how climate change affects our farm workers. Our agricultural system is dependent upon them, and heat stress is a big issue. I just read an article this last summer talking about farm workers in India, and they've actually had to shift to sometimes harvesting in the night, and they have been facing increased exposure to things like venomous snakes and things like that. So it can affect things in ways that I wouldn't have initially thought of. Increased pests in the way we operate currently leads to increased pesticide use and increased pesticide exposure for the workers. There, a lot of these environments, they would be exposed to disease vectors, and we're expecting increases in vector-borne diseases like mosquito-borne diseases, tick-based diseases, things like that. And then air pollution exposure. We've had a lot of wildfires lately, and farm workers, working in wildfire smoke, that's a significant risk to them. Just being outside when it's hot, air pollution is higher. So significant risks there. And then it's important to realize the context of this. Often farm workers have language barriers. They have decreased access to healthcare. And in general, we still don't have very good worker protections for farm workers in the US. So that is that. Climate change disruptions to the transportation and storage. So most of our food moves by water, or a large portion of our food moves by water. So whether that's rivers or seas, that's an important means of transportation. I put these up because this is kind of ludicrous, right? Like in September, we had increased grain prices because the Mississippi River was suffering from drought. Less than 6 months later, we have problems with shipping because now the Mississippi River is flooding. So you're hearing more about these kinds of things. Europe, we've heard about this. So drought and flooding impact our ability to transport food. Extreme storms, things like hurricanes, monsoons impact shipping. Globally, the transport infrastructure is not great. So you can imagine a monsoon wiping out a road from a rural area where most food is produced, could shut down that food supply. Sea levels rising affect port cities, and that's where a lot of food comes and goes. Fires, disruptions to railways, and then power outages really impact storage. And I think about this. My parents live in Northern California in wildfire area, and sometimes now they shut off the power for a few days to try to prevent sparking in during times of high wind. And so they, everything in their refrigerator and freezer is gone. And then if you amplify that to the grocery store level or to storage warehouse level, that's a lot of food that's subject to being lost. And we're seeing increasing power outages as it gets warmer. It's, there's more cooling needs. And we saw in Texas recently, there were heating needs. They had an extremely cold winter and suffered blackouts. This one's climate change on food waste. This one's kind of obvious from what I've talked about before, but things like unexpected crop loss in the fields. Farmers in Arizona were telling me this summer that they were seeing things like their food literally melting and rotting on the vine with the heat that we had. Food has a decreased shelf life because bacteria work quicker in hotter temperatures. So when you have disruptions, like we talked about, to harvesting and transportation and storage, you just have a shorter time period to get that food to people before it's viable, before it loses viability. Globally, we don't have a great cooling infrastructure, which is really going to become much more important. And then things like when you have flooding, and flood water doesn't discriminate. It may move through an industrial facility. It may move through a factory farm. Whatever toxic exposures or diseases that water picks up, if that gets into a field, all of those crops are lost. They can't be fed to people. And then just thinking about food access. So these are USDA projections of food prices on under different emission scenarios. And so this emission scenario is predicting high emissions and very restricted trade. And if you think about in situations when food scarcity happens, countries tend to shut down their trade. So that's, not unlikely that in situations of food scarcity, we would see restricted trade. So you can, they're predicting as much as 30% increase in food prices. So that right there will eliminate, will limit a lot of people's ability to access food. Migration, from climate events makes it harder for people to get food. There's just like, for instance, when we had the wildfires in the Pacific North, or not so in the heat stroke, the heat wave in the Pacific Northwest a couple years ago, we lost a large proportion of global grain supply for that year. So some things just might be less available. Economic disruptions from climate events or other limit people's ability to purchase food. And then particularly in rural areas, if you have just one source of food and that is disrupted, there's lack of transportation to access other types of food sources. And then climate impacts on livestock production. So animals are subject to the same heat stress that people are, and they have increased mortality during heat waves. They will have behavioral changes, including eating less when it gets hot. So that makes a difference for how much food an animal ultimately provides. They reproduce less efficiency in the heat. There's a reduction in feed and forage available for them. Sometimes they're subject to extreme cold, like snap freezes and blizzards and unexpected things like that. Dairy cattle tend to have lower milk quality and yield when the temperature shifts. We may see a shifting of where we can raise animals depending on the temperatures. And this one, so animals have been shown to have decreased immune function, which impacts how well they respond to vaccination. And you guys have, I think you've probably heard, so zoonotic diseases are kind of expected to rise, and that makes up a good portion of emerging diseases now. We've seen disruptions to the food supply in the case of highly pathogenic avian flu over the last couple of years. And I don't know if you guys are aware, we have culled about 80 million birds. So if you remember, I think it was about a year ago, we had a huge surge in egg prices. That's because, once those viruses get into a farm facility, those birds then all have to be culled. So that represents a pretty significant risk to our food supply. And who are the people who are most at risk? And this goes along with the social determinants of health. Women, pregnant people, children, they are higher risk. Low-income households that don't have the means to purchase more expensive food. I want to highlight Indigenous people and fishing and subsistence dependence communities because these communities, are suffering loss of fishing stocks, maybe suffering loss of access to traditional hunting grounds because either they can't get to them anymore or the grounds are no longer viable. As we saw in the US, certain groups of people are suffering from higher levels of food insecurity. Small-scale producers who are often rural people, somewhat paradoxically, are very susceptible to food insecurity. And then people who live in areas that are prone to climate risks, particularly Africa and Central America, they are pretty susceptible to having their food disrupted. Okay, is everybody super depressed yet? So, like I said before, this topic actually excites me, because I think we have a lot of opportunities to improve this. And so what are some of these? So this is just kind of, my view on the road to a sustainable food system. We need to eat diets that are healthy and sustainable, and I'm going to talk more specifically about this in just a second. We can improve food production practices. We can decrease food waste. We can improve food equality. And we can increase resiliency of food systems so that they're not so subject to disruption. So I want to talk a little bit about the diet aspect. And there's a paper, I'd be happy to provide a reference for it. Came out in 2019. It's called Food in the Anthropocene. It came out in Lancet, and it was a group of, I think, almost 40 different scientists from all different disciplines. And they basically looked at all the literature on health, social sciences, environmental impacts of agriculture. And they came up with dietary recommendations for the world based on two endpoints. One is sustainability from a greenhouse gas emission standpoint, and two is maximizing health of diets. And so they this is a schematic showing foods, and high in this case is highly negative impact. So foods that have a highly negative environmental impact and a highly negative health impact are in this quadrant. So you can see red meat falls in here. And then this opposite quadrant down here, all of these in orange are foods that they say should be emphasized in diets. And they broke this down into a diet that is not culture specific. It is not prescriptive. It is not a vegan diet. It's not a vegetarian diet. It's just a rebalancing of diets. And in some parts of the world, it involves decreasing predominantly animal source protein and dairy, and increasing vegetable intake almost universally. But also some parts of the world, it does involve increasing some source of animal protein because that's deficient in diets. There's an emphasis on plant source protein, which is predominantly legumes and nuts. And according to their modeling, if the world were to adopt this diet, not only could we address the harmful effects of agriculture on climate change, but we could also prevent 11 million adult deaths a year, roughly, depending on how you calculate it, just from the dietary changes associated with the poor diet that most of the world eats. So, what are the solutions? Am I doing okay on time? Okay. And this is solutions, according to me. There's a lot more out there, and there's a lot of really smart and dedicated people that are working in a lot of these areas. And I can't provide examples of all of them, but I certainly could provide some really cool resources to see what people are doing. But we need to improve food production practices, things like crops that are climate adapted, crops that support healthy diets, managing our soil better. And I don't know if you guys have heard of regenerative agriculture. That's actually making it potentially into the next farm bill. Improving the way we use water, using fertilizers and inputs in a smart way so that we're, giving them to the plant when they need them, in the appropriate amounts versus, just blanket dumping them. And there's a lot of technology that can manage both of these things that's coming out. And then diversifying our crops so that we have, more to adapt, more crops to adapt to. On the consumer and society level, so that diet was called the planetary diet. Adopting that globally, or at least moving towards that type of a diet, using means of cooking that require low energy inputs, decreasing our food waste at the household level, and then in general, we need some changes around food culture because if we're going to change diets globally, culture has to change along with that. On the government side, there's a lot that can be done. So, making sure that subsidies go towards appropriate foods and foods that support a healthy and a sustainable diet, ensuring that programs are in place for food access to those who need it, addressing food waste on a more global scale. We currently have dietary recommendations, and a good chunk of countries do. Some countries have adopted sustainable dietary recommendations, and that should increase. Ensure that our food system is safe, and improving food resiliency, so improving the number of places that we get food in any given society. And then, of course, we have to continue climate mitigation. So this can be done agriculturally. We can improve our ecosystems and the biodiversity. Agriculture has the potential to be a carbon sink versus a carbon emitter. Having resilient and sustainable methods of transportation and storage, and then, of course, reducing greenhouse emissions in all sectors. And I want to close with this. I have worked a lot in different nonprofits associated with food systems over the years. And I've become really convinced that the skills that physicians have are really useful in society. And these are the things, according to me, that I think we bring into the mix. You know, we came into this because we are compassionate people and we care. We interact with diverse populations, and no matter how you want to define diverse populations, I think we interact with them on a daily basis and have those skills for negotiating differences. Physicians lead teams, whether that be educational teams or practices or multidisciplinary teams. The physicians tend to be very comfortable in leadership roles. And this one I think is huge. We make and we implement plans. So often I see people paralyzed by inaction, but for physicians, that's not really an option. We have to make decisions with the best available evidence that we have. And I think that is an extremely useful skill. We learn to negotiate, whether that's with hospitals or insurance companies or patients or families or each other. We get pretty comfortable in that role. And then we are comfortable researching evidence and making evidence-based decisions. So where do I see the role of physicians in climate change? Obviously, in patient care and education, that's an important role that we play, and we can teach patients of their risks. We can teach them to adapt and to their risks. We can teach them, you know, where their agency is and where their ability to impact changes. But also, I see that physicians are really important in the advocacy and policy development side. In general, I don't see a lot of us doing this work, but we provide a really important perspective and important voice. And often I see the health aspects of these things go unappreciated. And then in community, I think physicians bringing all their skills out into the community really have the opportunity to exact change. So with that, I'm done, and I'm happy to take any questions that you guys have.